My name is Pascaline Dupin. I'm an associate professor of economics at Stanford University, and I'm also co-chair of the health sector for J-PAL. So like many people, I aspire to a world where everybody can have a happy and productive and healthy life. So the work I try to do is helping think through the type of policies and programs that can bring us closer to that, and realizing that the prime starts very, very early in people's lives. So there's a lot of evidence showing that if your mother is very young when you're born, you're going to have a lower birth weight, you're going to have a harder time growing on par for your age later on in life. You're going to end up getting less education. This is in part because your mother is younger when she gives birth. She, you know, her own health may be affected by the pregnancy. Her bodies may not be ready for the pregnancy and the birth. But also most likely because she's very young when she has a child, she doesn't have much resources, and so she will have less to provide. She may be a single mom. And so there is very, very strong evidence that being born to a teenage mom makes it much harder for the children. There's still a lot of adolescent girls who get pregnant every year. So how do we make progress on that? You really want to think about the context in which these pregnancies happen. So there are some parts of the world, in particular in South Asia, where most of the teenage pregnancies happen within marriage. And so really here, the situation is that parents have a preference to marry their daughters early. That's what you see in the data. There's a number of reasons why that may be the case. One that is very often mentioned is the dowry system, for example. And so for that, doing research, trying to understand really what do parents respond to? What are the key reasons why the dowry responds so much to the age of the daughter? Can it be changed if the daughter has more education, if there are more labor market opportunities? In other contexts, like in many countries in Sub-Saharan Africa where I've worked on, teenage pregnancy happens often before my age. So in that case, you want to think about, well, why is it that starting a family early seems to be a good idea for these girls? And there's a lot of evidence that this is because they cannot afford to go to school, and so that that's why they are at home. And so if you make education more accessible for them, there's a lot of evidence from work that we have done in Kenya for the middle school level, and then in Ghana at the secondary school level, that this really reduces teenage fertility, because now these girls know, well, I can be in school, I can learn stuff, and then when I come out of school, I can also use my skills on the labor market, and maybe having young children is going to prevent me from really capitalizing on these skills. And so that's what we call in economics the opportunity cost of time, that when you have more education, it's costlier to spend a lot of time just at home with the children rather than earning a wage on the labor market. And so education has this effect of both keeping you in school instead of being at home, and also changing the calculation that you're going to make for the rest of your life in terms of the trade-off between being at home and in the labor market. There is a fine line between saying teen pregnancy is bad and so it should not happen, and enabling those who nevertheless end up in this situation to cope with it the best possible way. And so there are a number of countries that have very strict rules as to who is eligible for certain services. And so in particular, to not look like you're endorsing teenage pregnancy, countries that have cash transfer programs for women who give birth in a hospital, like in India, say, okay, if you're a teenage girl, you won't be getting that payment, because they're afraid that otherwise it would incentivize teen pregnancy. But that ends up really hurting those who do not have the information or the resources to avoid this outcome. So I think understanding the extent to which indeed the policymakers' concerns about the potential enticing effects of making these services available to teen moms are our relevant concern is very useful, because if we knew that actually it's not the case that if I know I can get a cash transfer, if I deliver my child in the hospital, it's not going to change anything about my decision as a teenager because there are so many other factors. Then we could have policies that are, you know, not have eligibility criteria based on age, which would mean that those who don't manage to avoid sex in teenage years could get access to family planning, and those who don't manage to avoid marriage in teenage years could have access to resources like antenatal care and delivery care, even if they are below 18.